This is Richards TV. Welcome and thank you for joining us on the Christmas edition of your program, Talking Point. Well, Christmas is around the corner. I can feel the flavor. How are you preparing? You have to understand that if you drink, don't drive. If you drive, don't drink. Stay alive so you can arrive for your family. Welcome once again to Talking Point, another interesting moment to talk lifestyle, people, and politics. Today, we have a distinguished personality, one whose integrity is not in doubt, a politician, an entrepreneur, and of course, a youth development personality. Talking about the former chief of staff, Imo State Government, His Excellency Ogumba Uchenwosu, candidate, Action Alliance, in the March 9, 2019 gubernatorial elections. It's my pleasure to welcome you to the program, Your Excellency.
Thank you.
It's been a long time. One would imagine, seeing you at this level, that perhaps you were born a whole like this. You were never a baby. So, yes. So we'd like to know, how was it like growing up at Ezeoma Obire? Your childhood, we'd like you to talk about it.
Yeah, at my childhood, I think I was not among those who were born with a golden spoon.
Okay.
I grew up like same way I tried from a very poor family. My dad, who was a Catholic in the Anglican Church, and my mom, who was a teacher in the primary school. Being a Catholic and being a pastor in an Anglican church, it was the issue of moving from one church to another. Because they were transferred from one place to another. And being a child, I remember one day, one morning that we woke up, and it was a Sunday morning, and we were like, no, we don't want to go to the church. I remember that my dad flogged the hell out of me.
Okay, didn't want to go to church.
For even mentioning that, because, you know, as early as 5:36, we were awake.
Wow.
Because we start dressing, we start arranging, we go to the church, and then clean the church with the church workers.
Wow.
Before the service will start. So he made sure that we participate in the church activities. So it was a normal thing, and I thank God for that upbringing, because if we hadn't had that opportunity to serve and not allowing people to serve us even in the church, it would have been a different thing. So the service also groomed me and my senior ones and the siblings to where we are today. So I grew up from a family that's not an affluent family, or a family that came from the rich side of the a family that is poor. By the special grace of God, we find ourselves where we are today, through His blessings.
And also, growing up in the village, what flavor was it like?
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. And what would you be missing right now?
I remember those days when very early in the morning, as early as 5:36, we used to go to this, what do you call it again? Odara.
Oh. The Star Apple?
The Star Apple, yeah. Okay. Very early in the morning, we'll go there. You know, then there was, we don't go, some come with lantern.
Okay.
Some come with a small light or touch light, but you keep moving. If you hit one with your leg, you say, I caught one. So,
okay.
It was fun.
And
I remember those days. It was a very funny days, those days. During rain, me and my friend, Wahab and the rest of them, we jump into the river and start playing. And sometimes when we come back from school, we enter the bush. And we say we're going to look for squirrel and the rest.
They
see us with
bushmeat.
Yeah, bushmeat.
Hunting.
We can move from here to 1 kilometer looking for bushmeat. You know, it was fun. And those days, you hardly hear about child kidnapping, or you hardly hear about kidnapping, and there are all these stories that we hear today.
Okay.
Because, it was a life that people are used to. People cherish friendship and brotherhood. So we are not afraid of anything. But it was, I think it was one of the best moments growing up with your friends in the village, having time to go to the farm and go for beer and go for corn, whatever you need. You don't need to go to market, the farms are there. But another aspect of it is that when you come back from work, you know, my mother left teaching and then became a trader. She was a little finished and everything.
Okay.
So when you come back from work, from school, my mom inside the market will say, "Have you gone to farm?" You know, you say, "Oh my God, are we going to the farm?" Reluctantly, we take our home, we now move to the farm. But never knew that she was training us. And on Saturdays, as early as 6 o'clock, we go to the farm and we'll be there till we go with food, with a small shelter.
Wow.
And then she will use her wrapper with 4 sticks
and put a shelter.
And put a shelter with her wrapper. And then after the work, after some little bit of farming and cultivation, we'll just come there and eat. It was fun, but to us then, it was
stress. Man is stressing us.
Why should we go to farm? Why? But I never knew that all those days, what she was doing, she was training us actually to be a good ambassadors of the family. And that's the benefit today. That is what I do.
There seems to be a complete departure. You talk about kidnapping, children moving around from one compound without fear, and people living together. Have we lost that, those values in our society?
Yes, partially we have lost that because of the modern trend of things.
Yeah.
Because I remember those days, talking about that those days, you know, you don't care, you don't even know. A child of 10 years can jump inside the water when it's raining,
yeah,
and start jumping and start, you know, having fun. Even at the age of 12, at the age of 14, you see people remove their clothes and start moving inside the water. Things are changing because of the modern and the moving from locomotive to jets, and we're moving to rocket age. These days, you hardly see a baby of 5 years or 3 years, a boy of 2 years or 3 years, naked. They are beginning to know, I'm naked, mommy, I'm naked.
Oh, there's so, consciousness.
Yes, those things are part of the things that by the time a child gets to 10, started knowing about things he is or she is not supposed to know about. So the issue is that I don't blame them because we can't remain in that old age, that locomotive age. We have to move to another age. But even though that we're moving from that age to another age, we also have to be conscious of our culture. Like, there is no community or no family or even a city or a country that can grow by moving their culture. No matter how we look at the Western world, they still maintain their culture. So we also, as we move from those locomotive age to jet age to rocket age, we also have to blend in our culture. I think culture is part of the thing that is fast pulling out from our system. Once we have that culture,
everything will be fine. Okay, moving away, then you had the sojourn into life. You started to say, I want to be a man to fend for myself, to take care of my family. How did you start? Because today you find out that it's not easy for young people to be motivated to start, the inspiration to start a thing, to say, I want to make 100,000 to start. How did you start as a Gumbau Chemosu? Can you share this experience with us?
Asoba, but let me tell you something. It started after I lost my dad. By 1983, I lost my dad at a very tender age. I was seven, eight then. When I lost my dad, he was a bad one for us then. After some few years, we lost our senior brother, who's an person officer, who was the breadwinner of the family. Then, to us, it's like the world has come to the end. And here you see my mom and my elder sister. She's still in school. My mom is a teacher, and we were like eight in the family. And I was still in secondary school. So it becomes the issue of how will she be able to train this number of children? One day, my uncle came back from Maiduguri. I was playing with the kids, and the kids stayed with us for 2 days. So when they were going, I started crying that I want to go with my uncle, but I want to go with them. And before you know it, I found myself in Medellin.
Wow.
I went to Medellin and I took my primary school at Sheru Sande Kelemi Primary School. Part of my secondary school, I was going to secondary school to Bio. I had friends. I knew how to speak Hausa. I speak Kanuri.
Wow.
And there in Medellin, especially in government secondary school to Bio, Bio town itself, I had friends, Abraham, Michael, and so many of them.
Okay.
We were not looking at ourselves, we're not looking at each other as you Muslim, you Christian.
So, okay.
Let me tell you this story. The most important thing that I still remember very well vividly today is that if my friend Abraham is going to the mosque, I'll follow him. I'll wait outside the
mosque.
When Abraham finished, we'll go we'll go to our prayer and then our classes.
Okay.
And we'll call it Yahweh in Hausa.
Okay.
We'll go to our Yahweh and then go for classes, lessons. Then on Sunday, while I'm going to church, Abraham will follow me and wait outside. Abraham will be outside waiting for me until after the service. He will come and say, ah, let's go. We'll go and then have fun, visit our friends. This is the relationship there. During school, you hardly hear about this is a Christian, this is a Muslim. We are bonded. And that also helped me a lot. It helped me to know about the culture of the environment. It helped me to know about the
religion itself.
Of Islam. It helped me to blend the two and know where this is going and where this is going. It helped me to know that we are serving one God. There are no two gods. The God of a Muslim is the same God that a Christian worships. But the misunderstanding should not be there. That is the major problem.
Okay.
Again, it's at the time I started Arabic language. In my GSS 1, GSS 2, I was interested in studying Arabic language.
Wow.
And I did Arabic language in my GSS 1
okay.
and GSS 2. So one day after the school, you know, it was a dormitory. From Medugri to Bugu is like almost 7 hours by road.
So the same
state. So
wow.
When I came back after the semester, I brought my book. My uncle, who is a pastor, and I brought my book. I said, uncle, if I can write Arabic now, tell me, and then I'll write it in Arabic. He said, what do you mean? I wrote his name in Arabic. He said, you studied Arabic? I said, yes. He said, my dear, I said, I love that language. I just want to know a little bit of Arabic. He was a little bit like, I said, no. I don't know what they're talking about, but I have a friend
okay.
who also is interested in knowing more about the Bible and even more about my language. So, then you only have one Nigerian language. It's either you do Igbo, Hausa, or Yoruba. So
okay.
I decided to do Hausa language. I did Hausa language in my GSS 1, GSS 2, GSS 3. That was one of the Nigerian languages I took.
Okay.
So I was able to know more about the culture of the Northern, especially the Kanuris. Kanuris are one of the tribes in this country that are very much accommodating, and when they are with you, they are with you. And then you see people sleep outside from 6 o'clock to the following morning. Nobody, and their doors open. A Kanuri man can easily accept you as his own. He does not care where you come from. He doesn't care if you're a Muslim or if you're a Christian. All he knows is that he, Kanuri man, will protect you if there is a fire. This is Kanuri man for me. So, when I was in my GSS 3, going to SS 1, my mom called that she wanted me back in the East to stay with her, being the first son, because the eldest son, because our first son died as a custom officer. So I left Medellin and then went to Aba. I was in Aba with my mom. Life was very difficult there. I got admission to Sacred Heart College in Guava. To finish my part of my GSS 3. I was in a super bar. I remember that whenever we come back from school, my mom will arrange the church with orange. People is doing the sales of orange. We kept on doing that. That was it. From the Zuku, to Mukasi, to Ariare, to Force Road, to so many places, to Everton, selling orange in order to make sure that we have something in the family. It is during the days of selling a boiled corn or boiled beer or coconut. You see us whenever we come. But one particular thing that God is faithful, you know, God is a great God because He knows how to provide for the poor. You can imagine that, but if we carry those things, before we get to 3 or 2 miles,
we'll sell it
and come back and to our mom, let's go and get more. So at the time, she will rush to the market, bring more, and we'll go and sell. It was like God is so faithful, and God is just the best doing it for us. So whenever I'm on the road shouting,
orange.
Buy oranges, buy corn, buy okra, your corn, Ati Beke, Marama, orange, Natoto, or even during the sale of Odara, you know, the apple itself, I would say, Odara, Wanu, you know,
right.
So Odara, Wanu, Odara, Wanu. So, you know, even on the course of doing that, and I see some of the people who are very well to be in the society, I ask myself, can there be a time that I will be like this group of people? And when I see flash cars pass, I say, God, I wish I could have this car. But that's wish. But we just have to wait for God to do His will. So we did all this, not because we wanted to do it, because of the condition we have found ourselves in. And I want to salute my mother, because if she did not train us to be hardworking and not to look
at
our situation at that present time, would have said, no, let's just start other things. But she wanted us to go through that so that we will remember there was a day that we were even walking on the street of our own 9 siblings. And before I knew it, I got admission. Then I got admission into Imo State University. You know, first of all, I got admission at Abia Poly.
Okay.
When I got admission, there was no money. But I didn't want to go to Abia Poly. I didn't want to go to the polytechnic. I wanted to go to the university. So when I got admission into Abia State Polytechnic, there was no money. So my mom cried and begged that I should invest that money. Then I got another admission at Ring Poly. The same thing. She pleaded that we should give ourselves time to have one. Then the last one, I got admission into the same bus. I told her, you know, I must go to the bus. I came back. She said, that would go about it. That she doesn't have money for some kind of school. I told her, I said, we will make it. My sister came, my mother, because I had senior sisters, they said, no matter what, we are going to see that they are going to see that I get into the university. I remember one morning, I was going to the university to do my registration. I woke up that morning. I was about to win, and my mom called me. She said, this is some of the jewels my dad bought from her.
She had to sell it?
Yeah, she said she wants to sell it, or she wants to use that for me. My sister was crying, she said, Mom, my mom, get me in here, you can't do this. She said, what will she do? At least let her have her first son go to university. So, the rest.
What was the emotions at that time?
I felt.
What gave you this courage? Like, what did you feel inside? What gave you the inspiration? Even with all of these hard, turbulent, difficult situations, what propelled you?
Because I was not looking at my background, okay. I was looking at what future holds for me.
Okay.
I was not. Looking at the family I'm coming from, I'm looking at God Almighty, who is the of the information of our effects. So I will always say that I have to be looking at more after the way we did say that she got money from business and my sister also struggled and then got money. And so before you know it,
you were in the university.
I went to the university. When I got to the university, the day I was going when I was going to wear it, my mom called me and said, "You have seen that you are my first son as it is now.
Wow.
You just have to, you don't have one. Don't go and blend with this big people." You see, you know, when you get to the university, you see people with money. So when all these things were happening, I was just looking at them. That message was spelled there, fresh in my memory. And I said to myself, can I stop collecting school fees for my mom and my sisters? Because I have other younger ones who are still in school. If she gathered everything and give back to me, what happens to
the other one?
So one holiday, I went to the village and I met one of my uncle who is into building and I asked myself, uncle, I'm interested in case there are places that you have people who are into construction, who want to build a house for them, but I can also help you with block and this as well. He said, why? I said,
while in the university.
While in the university.
Okay.
So before you know it, I started working with him. So whenever we have vacation, I'll go to the village and then carry blocks, do messy work, and then by Sunday, I'm off to the university. So I did this continually. I was doing it, but most of my friends in the university didn't know that I was doing it. But when I come back to school, I wash my clothes and I would dress clean. But they don't know what I was doing. It was just few of them that are from my local government that know actually that I go to do messy work. But I was not ashamed of it because I wanted to get to somewhere. And I did that until I, session like that, I heard that there is a student union government election. Then I said, look, what's cool? I can run for student union government election. And I called my friends that were in the same class. I said, look, I want to run for director of transport. They were like, do you have the money? How do you want to run for student union government election? You don't have money. You think this is for poor boys? So jokingly, before they know about it, from the little money I got from the jobs that I did in the low in the village, I then bought the form. And before you know it, I registered before me. I started campaign. Then during my campaign, they were calling me ABC because I told them once I win, I will bring ABC Transport into the university.
So they were calling you ABC.
Yes, ABC.
ABC Transport.
Yes. Because I told them once I win,
okay,
you have ABC. And those who live in Lagos will go, I'll make sure ABC comes and take them to Lagos. Those who live in Abuja, ABC will take them to Lagos. So people started having interest in my campaign. Before you know it, whenever I go to classrooms and some hosted to campaign, say
ABC.
Before you know it, the election came and I won. I became the first director of transport students in the university. And we are being paid salary.
Wow.
So with the salary, whenever we are paid salary, I will take some of the money to my mom. Oh, I want anything. I said, for me, I'm now a director of transport. She said that she come. I came back to the back and she prayed for me and said, I to have her. She said, God will bless me that I should keep on. From there, I became the secretary of the Students Union Government. From there, I became the secretary of NANS, Imo State Chapter. From there, I became one of the National Mobilization Officers of NANS. From there, I knew Rogers, Ole Rogers Okocha. I came to knew business Ole Rogers Okocha one day when he was running for governorship in Imo State. We went to him and among the candidates, we saw him as one of the youngest and we are determined to work with the younger people there.
Okay.
So when we went to his office, we said, "Yes, Excellency, we want to work with you. We see you as a man who will never leave you." And said, "Sure, yes." He gave us some few assignments we went and did, and before you know it, we are working with him. But, you know, part of the politics, he went and then lost. And, so many of my friends left.
Wow.
But we still have that touch with him.
Okay.
Sometimes he invites us to Abuja, we go to Abuja and stay with him, and then come back. So we have that touch with him. And at the time, we formed what is called Richards Club International, with most of the high institutions in Nigeria. We were working with him and also being a student until after my graduation. He now said, "Look, I want you to work in my foundation."
Okay.
And
that's Richards Foundation.
Richards Foundation. And he told the DG then, Mr. Obinale, that he wants me to be part of the foundation. And that was how I became the PA to the DG then, Richards Foundation. I worked with the DG Richards Foundation. We were the first, in fact, we set up the first Richards Foundation College in the world. The pioneer students of Richards Foundation College were actually established the first school, Richards Foundation College in the world.
Where?
And from there, one day he came back and said, "A lot of people have been talking about you. I want to take you so that you can become my own PA." And before you know it, that was how.
Oh, you were initially PA to the DG
of the foundation.
Oh,
that was how.
You now became the PA to the president.
To the president.
Okay.
I became the PA to the president, and PA to the president, I became the deputy chief of staff to the president of the Richards Foundation. And when he was the advisor to President Olusegun Obasanjo, I was his PA. He became the president of the Nigerian Red Cross. I was his PA, and later the chief of staff, the president of Richards Foundation. So I had this relationship with him over the Richards. I was not following him because of his money. I was following him because I saw a mentor and I saw a role model in him.
Okay.
I saw him as a hardworking young man then, and I saw him as somebody who is not looking at his background. The same way I was not looking at my background, because he told us his story, how he started, how he was selling okreka in Jos, how he was working press and oil school in Jos. So I see he has the same story with my story. So I wanted to have a mentor and a role model who understands the difficulties in life, not actually a mentor who does not even know what you went through, who you'll be looking at money. I wanted to connect, to be able to know how he made it in life. So this thing was my relationship with him. I wanted to know how he made it in life from that background, the same background. So I blended. So many of our people left, but I remained with him. Even at the time, after the presidential election there, it was difficult to carry all the number of staff to work with him.
Okay.
So many left, but we remained with him, saying, "Yeah, yes, let's see. Even without salary, we want to work with you."
Because many
of us say we want to work with you, and we remained with him. By the special grace of God, he became the governor of Imo State. And this is how we found ourselves. And so many of them that left came back, knowing who Ole Richards Okocha
is.
He forgave all of them and still gave them appointment, because this is the man,
Richards,
the type of man who Senator Richards is.
What was it like for you, at first deputy chief of staff to the governor and then chief of staff? The whole euphoria, the environment, the people, the politics, how was it inside Imo State Government House?
First, I have to say thank you to Excellency Olusegun Richard Okocha, who gave me the opportunity to serve my state as a young man. Then I was the youngest in the government then. At the age of 32, I was already deputy chief of staff for Excellency Olusegun Richard Okocha. Yeah, knowing who Olusegun Richard Okocha is, Senator, he's a workaholic. He's not a man that will sit without creating something. So if actually you really want to work with him, you must be ready to work 24/7. So to us that have been with him before and coming to work in the government, we already know who he is. And we already know, like, this man is not coming to church. This man has come to work. So we have prepared our mind that there is no sleep. We sleep around 3, wake up around 6, and this was how the entire journey was. So we make sure that his dream to have a better imam is being realized. Being the missioner himself, and we being the co-missioner, we just have the option than to also help the missioner carry out his mission in the state. And we did this knowing that posterity would remember us in the state. So for me, it was a service to humanity and a service to my state. Being a young man and coming from the background before we came in, that young people are considered as people who cannot serve in some certain position, like Deputy Chief of Staff, commissioners, but now you see a position that is meant for people at the age of 60, 70, being occupied by somebody who is 30, his 30s. So a lot of expectation. Let's see whether these young people will be. But we did not disappoint the young ones in the state. We also make sure that from bringing us into the system, people now realize, oh, somebody at the age of 20 or 30
can do something.
Because these are the brains. These are the people who knows where the system is going, who can google, who knows what is happening outside the world. People, there are people who are at
with the age of
90, they don't know what is happening. Those ones are already getting tired. But the younger ones actually can read address with their iPhone or with their laptop, not necessarily writing it on paper. And these are the young people the government needed then. And and these young people are creative. They understand the system. So we did not disappoint the youth in Imo State. We made them proud. And being a deputy chief of staff, my assignment is to assist the chief of staff there, while also having my own job.
Okay.
As I've been assigned to me by His Excellency, the then governor of the Secretary of Agriculture. I was the deputy chief of staff operation.
Okay.
Operation means that most of the operational work is movement, some things that relate personally to him, and some that is outside the government house that need to be assigned to me. I did it to my press to make sure that I did not disappoint His Excellency or the operation.
Okay, then you now have the inspiration from there, taking a look at how we're able to manage being PA to the President Richards Foundation. You now occupy the position of the Chief of Staff, and then you had the hiccups. You have met people personally, and then you now develop charity, and then you were called the Youth Development Manager of the people. How were you able to marry your position with the development of youth in such quantums?
The issue of development of the youth was something that is born in me, and is something that I desire to do. Coming from a background that you see a young man walking on the street and treading on the streets, I'm growing up from that particular background, and finding myself in a position that I'm privileged to have access to governments and to have access to help people. I said to myself, this is where I'm coming from. And to me, I knew that there are thousands of people, of younger people, also going through that process. And one thing I decided then was that I am not going to finish from this office. Because whether you like it or not, you're a governor, you're a chairman, you're a president, you must leave that office one day. Like people will say, it's like a barber seat. You come and barber and go, another person come and barber and go, or like a barber. So that will come.
So there will go.
So I said to myself, this position can either last for 4 years, 2 years, or even 1 month, depending on how long the governor wants you to stay. But what should I be remembered for? Should I be remembered for that I was a big teacher for staff and I was living large, wearing good shoes, good clothes, living in a good house, without impacting something to people's lives, especially the youth in Imo State? So I took up that challenge that at least I should have a foundation that will take care of the young people, knowing their needs. Those of them who are graduates who think that the world has finished because there is no job, they can start up small business. Some of them that did law, I think that when there is nowhere to go or no chamber to go, or some of them that did medicine, when there is no hospital to go, that they
die on the street.
But knowing that even as a doctor, when the other one is not coming, you must have address B and address A. You must start something. You can have a barber shop. Not necessarily means that you go there and start up and you can employ somebody. You can have a fashion designing
outfit.
Not necessarily that you must be there to start sewing. You employ somebody. You can have a farm. Not necessarily that you must sit there and you can farming. Get somebody. But these are address B. When address A is not working, you move to address B. And most of you walk into it. So that was my desire to help as many people as I can. That was why at the time it became the issue of the commander general of youth empowerment.
Yes, the commander general of youth empowerment.
The general of youth empowerment.
Yeah, the commander general of youth empowerment.
I will keep saying that if you, in any nation, any state, or any community, if you build the youth, you are automatically building that mountain or that community or that family or that state. But if you destroy them, it's a problem.
But let me come to you. Do you think there is a complete departure at the moment, not necessarily in Imo State, let's take Nigeria in general. Do you think there is involvement of the Nigerian youth in politics or in governance? And if yes, to what extent should we advance this cause?
Yes, of course. In fact, our President Muhammadu Buhari, one thing he did for the young people was the not too young to run here.
Okay.
That has helped.
Okay.
Because they put it to that age that if you are not 45, you cannot run for any elective position. When you go to some states now, or your state, and so many states, you see young people who are at the age of 30, 31, 28, as speakers of House of Assembly. But before now, if you are not 40 or 35, you can't run for elective position. So I think I will give it to President Muhammadu Buhari, who by his wisdom, decided to sign that bill or that law into law, so that the young ones will have privilege to be into government. Because it is not all about having the old people alone to be in governance or to handle position. The younger ones should be allowed to test. Let's try them. Obi is a boy. Obi is
a boy for how long?
He cannot be a boy for years.
Okay.
So I think the society we are now, we should give the young people an opportunity to showcase what they have. And with this, we can either say, our daddies, we have learned from you people. Why don't you allow us to work? So that when we come back, we say, daddy, we are back. Then give you people what you did.
Okay, let's move now to but before I ask you about the March elections, the gubernatorial elections, what would you have done differently if you were the governor of Imo State? What would you have done differently in terms of youth development, in terms of agriculture, in terms of empowerment, in terms of transportation? What would you have done? Because your campaign strategy was, I've come to work.
Okay, I think I stopped at the office of the Deputy Chief of Staff. Remember that I was Commissioner for Lands.
Oh,
remember that from being the Deputy Chief of Staff, I now became the Commissioner for Land. And when I was Commissioner for Land, it was like, hey, this young man, or say young boy, coming to take over as Commissioner for Land. What does he have to offer?
You know?
I'm a town planner, and being a town planner, I knew that I was going through a system that, if I don't know at least 70% of the terrain, I know it as a town planner. So during my days as a Commissioner for Land, when I got to Commissioner for Land, the internal revenue of Minister of Land was 5 million. The internal revenue of the OCD, Owerri Capital Development Authority, was less than $1.2 million.
Are you serious?
But before I left that office, we were making up to $100 million. OCDA was making up to 40 to 50 to 60 million monthly. It's all about the brand, and also it's all about dedication and knowing what you have gone to do in any organization, any office. When I came into Ministry of Lands in Imo State, we have a lot of problems, land problems.
Okay.
In fact, the development in Owerri, if you know Owerri very well, the development in Owerri stopped at 40-40. Where you have shop right now, there was no single building around that area. If you are going towards Amakohia, building stops at that Amakohia roundabout. The other side of it, going towards Kwakoma, going towards Ibadan, those areas was like, don't even go there. And don't even try it, because the landowners will fight you.
Fight you.
Because they will ask you, why do you want to come and take our land? They knew where there was nothing in the world. In fact, those areas was the den of kidnappers, where they kidnap and kill and dump people's body there. But one thing that I did as a commissioner for land, I developed what I call dispute resolution.
Okay.
Where the landowners with the staffs of Ministry of Land will sit in a round table,
okay,
and discuss how do we solve these problems.
Okay.
We have lands that were acquired by the BCK.
Okay. The former governor.
Former BCK governor. 14 years ago. We have land that were acquired by Aneke. We have lands that were acquired by De Sampakwe, Enwerem, and so many of them, but you cannot go in and develop. Investors do not dare to enter those lands. So what I did as a commissioner for land, and through the help of my workers, the PAMSEC directors and the workers of the Ministry of Land, because when I came, they saw that we can't even go. If you mention Oga, we can't go. Mm-hmm. If you go there, the landowners will chase you with knife. Oga, this area, no go area. Well, I said, but how do we solve the problem? We cannot go. If every government that comes, you tell the government that they can't move into this area. I said, okay, I have a plan. Landowners, what do you actually want? Some of them say, no, that they've not been given compensation, and they don't have land again, that their land government has taken over all their land.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I was the first commissioner
mm-hmm.
in the Federal Republic of Nigeria that came with this idea. And the idea is what? I told them, yes, we are taking your 100 hectares of land. I am not only going to pay you, government is not going to only going to pay you compensation for cash crop and economic trees.
Okay.
We're also going to give you 20% of that land that we took from you.
Okay.
So if we are taking 100 hectares of land from you, we'll give you back 20% of those 100 hectares. That's around 20 hectares back.
Wow.
And this is to keep for children yet more. They thought it was government gimmicks. That's it's not true. Before you do it, I release 20% of land to those who get 100, those who get 50, those whose land were acquired, who government acquired 100, 200 hectares, all of them were given to 20% of their land, and they were given compensation. They said they have never seen this kind of thing before. They opened all the lands, and people, landowners, allottees moved in and started developing. In fact, they became the securities in those areas.
Wow.
And this is how we opened the Owerri. Being a commissioner for land, I was not looking at the party we belong to. At the time, some of our party members were like, how can you allow people from PDP? How can you allow people from another party to come and start building as if that we should stop them, because once they are building there, they are, no, this is government. Politics is over. I tell you one story. About Chikwe, the husband of Dr. Mrs. Kema Chikwe,
okay,
came to me one morning and he said, I am Da Abba Chikwe, the husband of Kema Chikwe, that I have a land at Igu Road where you have shop right today, that he's been coming to get the CEO of of that land, because there is a joint partnership between him and government. He started this during Shehu Shagari time. Till then, from Shehu Shagari till we came into power, nobody gave him CFO. And he said, look, my son, I want to bring him some light, and I want this land and the CFO. I told him, really, sir, you want to bring me ShopRite? He said, yes. I said, okay, give me 24 hours, I'll think about it. The following morning, I went back, I told his excellency, this is what this man came and said, he need that. I said, who is that? I said, the husband of Komachiko. To me, I was thinking that his excellency would say, Komachiko, you know we are not in the same party, he's a PDP. But to my greatest surprise, he said, oh, he's going to ShopRite, deal with him. I called him. The following morning, I said, sir, we are ready. We are going to give you the CFO, we are going to give you a building plan, and we are going to give you a conducive atmosphere for the ShopRite to come. He did not believe it. He said, really? I said, yes, sir, we are going to do it. He came to my office. He couldn't stand because he said, Achiku Demwa, he begged for the CFO for during the Achiku Demwa regime
for
8 years. He was not given. He begged for it during the Ikedo Hakim regime. He was not given. During the Nwem, it was not given. Tankosville, it was not given. Mbakwe, it was not given. That it was only us. That he's of PDP, but it was another party, APC, that gave him, that has accepted to give him this. That even if he did not get it, for just saying it, that he wants to thank me. Before you know, in less than 1 week, in less than 2 weeks, I signed up the CFO for him. Before you know it, I called the GM of OCDA. The building approval was approved. Before you know it, we gave him the building approval. Before you know it, he started ShopRite. Before you know it, he completed the ShopRite. And he called me and said he cannot believe it. This is the kind of system we ran. And this is the kind of system I wanted to run as commissioner for lands. Most of the lands allottees that were given land of PDP. I was not doing my party. I was carrying everybody along. I remember this story in Onoche Industrial Layout. One morning, I saw a letter from Ararube, Senator Ifeanyi Ararume. He was having problem with a Lebanese man. In fact, a Lebanese company went into his land in Onoche Road and occupied his land. So when that came to me, I called the director of land. I said, what is the problem? He said, we have problem with Senator Ifeanyi Ararume. And you know, Senator Ifeanyi Ararume was not in our party then. So the director of land was looking at me to say, no, leave it. So I said, no, bring it up. I said, what is the problem? The guy that came from Senator Ifeanyi Ararume, he now narrated the thing, not believing that the problem, he just came to see whether, just to say it. I said, so what do you want us to do? He said, he wants his land back. I don't ask the director of land. I said that, between Senator Ifeanyi Ararume, who wants to develop, and between this man who is not from here and who is not ready to go, who do you think? He was looking at me. I said, return back Senator Ifeanyi Ararume's land back to him.
Ogunbauchemo, so we would like you to reiterate to us what are those things you can look back on and say, beat your chest and say, I'm fulfilled. Having been in Imo State Government House, having touched one or two persons, I'm fulfilled. What are those things you can look at and say, thank God, I was...
First of all, fulfillment comes from the grace of God. I want to thank God that in my lifetime, I became a Deputy Chief of Staff to a Governor of a State. I became also a Commissioner for Lands, and also a Chief of Staff to the Governor of Imo State. So that alone, I want to really thank God, and I want to say is something that's been that is to me unfulfilled for occupying those positions. Another thing is I'm happy that Imo of yesterday is not the Imo of today. There's a lot of developmental projects. I'm happy that the young ones are now into politics, and they now realize that Obi cannot be a boy all the time. When you look at the scenario in Imo State today, you see that the younger ones are very much aware of the politics in the state, and they can contribute their own quota to Imo politics. Again, Looking at the youth in Imo State, I'm happy that during my own time, I was able to empower as many as I can with my office. I didn't use my office for myself and being selfish with the office. I opened the office of the Chief of Staff to the younger generation. I opened the office of Commissioner for Land to the younger generation. I opened the office of the Deputy Chief of Staff to the younger generation. My happiness is today that I appoint 200, even up to 1,000. I have also helped in getting job or empowering them or in putting them into a position of different position, either businesses, governmental position, and so many. So I want to thank God for giving me the opportunity to serve in Imo State.
Do you have confidence in the Nigerian judiciary?
Yes, I have confidence in the Nigerian judiciary, but I want to give it to the CJN, who one of the judges at conference, who said that judges should look at the merit of every matter and go towards
technicalities.
You caught a thief with an amber of a gun, and you've seen an amber of a gun, and there is a witness that said this amber was caught with a gun, but you say you need 3 witnesses. Meanwhile, 2 already have said that this armed robber is a gun, and you that is presiding, you are seeing the armed robber with that gun.
Okay, talking about family, you beautiful family you have there, and we can see your children. I just want to ask, do you want to have more?
Oh, that's a good question. My friends would always say, especially my friends would always say, come on, discuss a given child. If he comes,
okay,
you can't stop it.
But so what is parenting like for you?
I have a wife.
Okay.
We want to make it 4. Once we have 4 kids, we're okay with it. And also, I have a very, very lovely wife
who
she's very hardworking. You might be surprised that during our time in the state government, the issue of power and wealth did not matter. You can imagine my wife having her own shop where she sells minerals and stamps and some other things. Being the wife of the Chief of Staff and the wife of the Labour candidate, and also this daughter of the governor of Imo State, dead. He didn't move her. I have seen the daughters and sons of the governor, you see how they behave. You see when they go to the club, they go to the supermarket, they get this club, they go to the club, pub is closed. But you cannot, during the tenure of the Holy Church of the Culture, hear that his children have been behaving in a way. And this is a one for you. She carried herself, she concentrated on her business. She did not look at my dad is a governor or my husband is the Chief of Staff. He can only take a child from a very good upbringing to behave like that. So I have a very good home. We have 3 boys.
Wow.
And I thank God for them. And I thank God for giving me my wife, who is there for me, doing all this prior period, during the election. She was there, making sure that my supporters, my friends, and everybody is happy. So I thank God for giving me my wife.
Okay, as a politician, just before we wrap this up, there are moments you sit back and say, had I known, or I wish, or do you have some regrets, and what are they? Looking back at your life as a politician, you wish I were not a politician.
I can never wish that I'm not a politician, because everybody is a politician, even in your family. You know when you are growing up, and your dad comes back. And buy, maybe you are 4 in the family, and your dad comes back and buy something for everybody. You know, you want your dad to buy the best for you.
Okay.
One thing that you are playing politics.
Okay.
Because your politics is that you want your dad to love you more than others. Politics is everywhere. Even in when you see some of those people who are in a private organization, like oil company, people say, we're not politicians. You're a politician because some of them aspire to be GM or AGM
or DG.
Or DG. And they say, I want to be DG, please help me. You are politician, you are politicking. So for me, I have no regrets in being a politician. I started this from my secondary school. I was a timekeeper. I was a class monitor. I was a member of my departmental association. My Borapo Association, Borapo is the local government association. I was one of the officials. So my politics started from
way back
from the secondary school. So I have no regrets. But one thing is that as a politician, what do you have to give back to the society? Some answer politicians because of their selfish interests. But me, I answer politicians because I want to serve. I want to give back to the public, those who brought me out to serve them.
Okay, and in a language that people at home will hear you more, I'd like you to address more people.
First of all, I want to thank Imolat, and also want to encourage them. I have received support from Imolat, especially the younger ones. During the election, my first shot as the governorship in the governorship race, but it looks as if I've been there before. And this can only happen when you see people that love you genuinely. The love is there, and God willing, things will take its course. But the most important thing is that we should know that Imo State is our state, and you cannot destroy the state that you live in. Whether you like it or not, you can never call your state a rubbish state or a nonsense state, because that state is like our mother that gave birth to us. So for us, we just have to say God bless Imo State. And to our leaders, we also God bless our leaders. No abuses, no hate speech. We just have to pray for our leaders and believing that by the special grace of God, things will come back to normal. Nde Imo Morogno Nimo Njemono Anamekele Mad Dile Nde Padro Nde no nom nazo no shike now game to election. Nde wupano awundem jibiri especially nde ke umo korobia makana asin here kun here ku de beya opano umo korobia mene mjiriga drondoro chicha ne de kwe pere na ihe ane kuku ye na ulo uli ibe so nyobla oku ne madi apare la madi asokola na ni Imo State ebe bishichana Imo State ebe bibe bake uo tige chasi na ne moro gie mebi ene ne moro di age mebi Imo State age mebi baka ni Imo demma otere panaki Imo bibi kwena ome bine panaki iya iga ne eme une epe epere ne kuku a nde Amerika ne kusu Chukwu Gozi America. Kai wore kweni ani eku Chukwu Gozi Imo State. Ndi America ile ha ha so God bless America. Ayo wore ayo wore ike so God bless Imo State. Ai ne eku ta ne eku ye eku si ike Imo State ka dey man. Dey wore.
This is Richards TV.